Unfortunately, my wife passed away in 1983. Since then, I have to spend my summers in Vancouver, my winters at Chandigarh. Thanks to the Almighty, very lucky person. So, about the final match here. As we all know, hockey was born in Gateway, modern hockey. And 1908, Gateway to one world, and it was held in 1920, Gateway to one. Then 1928, 32, 36, India won. So there was no Olympics in 40 and 44 because of the Second World War. India came to final, Gateway came to final. Everybody thought, well, let's see, because they thought Great Britain did not participate in 28, 32, 36. So the stadium, Wembley Stadium was full. That will bear me up. I think big crowd, huge, the entire stadium was full. The present queen, she was there as a princess. Match started. Come on, Great Britain, come on, Great Britain, score a goal. More shouts, come on, Great Britain. After a few minutes, we scored a goal. I was lucky enough to score first two goals. And then we scored the first. Then some of them, come on, India. Then we scored the third goal and fourth goal, most of the Britons, come on, India, you make it half a dozen. Come on, India. So I give this example to everybody, but it's sporting nation.
Yeah.
I am proud to be here once again. Second thing I remember of that Olympics is we were ruled by the Britishers. They were tough rulers.
Jagnandan Singh, yeah. 1968, from Nakuru Harbinder Singh, Vipindi Deegan, the third one, I couldn't imagine one thing, India had produced a hockey team 1928 to 2004, there has always been a Sikh in the Indian hockey team. But what one thing India could not manage is to have a Sikh goalkeeper. I'm delighted that Amarjit Singh is here.
Yeah!
He played for Kenya in 68 and 72. I'm more delighted. Amarjit not only comes from the school, he went to the same school, Mangai High School.
Yeah.
The next speaker, someone who was born in Kenya, did his primary and secondary school hockey in Nairobi, and then went to study at the Lalpur Khalsa College in Punjab, where he played hockey in Pompeii with people like Ajit Pal Singh, the V Singh of Railways, like my first guest, he also played for Punjab University. Then came back to India, to Kenya. Went on to represent Kenya in 120 internationals. He was the captain of Kenya's team from 1973 to 1981. He also managed the 1984 Kenyan Olympic team and has coached in Canada. We've asked our speaker to give us an insight into training as an Olympian. Ladies and gentlemen, Surjit.
I think, ladies and gentlemen, after hearing Balbir, I was very fortunate that my parents decided that I should go to India and study. I think most of my hockey, which I learned, was from there. I had the opportunity of attending Balbir's camps. A number of people who played along with Balbir, or after them, or maybe on the later Olympic Games, I had the privilege of playing with them or playing against them in Punjab. I was very, very fortunate that I was at a college, Lalpur Khalsa College, where we had very, very distinguished players, and majority of them eventually played for India. I was very lucky that I was a classmate of Ajit Pal. Many of you would remember his name. He was the captain for the 1975 World Cup Indian team as well. I did learn a lot of things from them. We were very fortunate that we were very close to the place where India used to hold their camps at the Punjab police lines. And because our college team was the best in Punjab, we were offered, or we were asked to come and give practice games to the Indian teams on a regular basis, which gave us more practice, and we could learn more. And majority of the people who played in those Olympics, and I was lucky enough to be under their camps, see them train and teach the Indian teams, and then also us as well. So it is, I'll give you one of the examples, like at the Olympic levels, when you're looking at the Olympic levels, majority of the people are at the top of the game. It is just a very minor thing which needs maybe a change, or you could improve there. I'll give you one example. Now, this is an example on a school. There's someone, a friend of mine, was talking to me a little while ago, so maybe I'll pick up that idea. Now, in Kenya, that's many of you, when you played in the early 50s and 60s, Kenya was very well known of raising the ball, and people would actually know that now the ball is going to be raised because the position or the stance or the style was such that it was known. Now, when I went to the college in India, I started learning to scoop the ball on a moving ball from Ajit Pal. Right. So it was a question of spending hours and hours. So we used to spend about 3 or 4 hours every day. So it's a starting from 5 yards, then you copy him, then you 10 yards, 20 yards, and then so on. Then it became automatic. We were playing the intercollegiate Punjab University championships with the Khalsa College Amritsar. 2 days, we drew. On the second day, Ajit Pal got hurt on his finger, that means he was completely out. On the third day, I was put up as a center half, and that scoop came up. One scoop at the right time, into the circle, one goal, and that was the end of the story. Now, when I came back to Kenya as well, it was something very different. Majority of the people had not seen that. It is always stop the ball and then you lift the ball. And when I came up there, that is completely different. But I had mastered that over 3 years, but there was a lot of practice, a lot of training which had gone there. The practice also involved in when people were giving practice to the goalkeepers that they would be heading from the top of the circle. Some of us would be beating the goalkeeper with the scoops from the top of the circle. And the practice was so much that coming up onto the penalty strokes, it was not an effort at all. It used to be 8 yards then. It's now much easier. It's 7 yards. So from 8 yards, it was you could just put the ball into the net with your eyes closed. So the coming to the conclusion here, it's practice. It is without practice, nothing happens. We were very fortunate playing for the Canadian. I came up very late into the side there. Majority of my friends who were older to me, they had played much earlier, much before me. But I think in the 60s, Kenya had a very, very good record on the Olympic Games there. And I would like to share the memories of going into about 1971 when the first World Cup came into. We played two games. We lost to France the first game. We lost to India the next game. And that night, it was Diwali. So you can imagine that we are now 0 points. There is Germany 4 points, India 4 points, France 4 points, and we are just there zero. And everyone is enjoying on the tables, and there is Kenya with no points at all. And we were then, people were taunting us that Kenya go home, Kenya go home. And the next day we were playing Germany. And we hadn't lost to Germany for a very long time. And we beat them 3-1.
4-0.
Is it? 3-1, right? So, and then eventually we came up that the points were equal, and then we had to play them again. So we on a rest day, when the other countries were resting, we were now playing a rematch with Germany again, and we beat Germany again. And then on the playoffs, we lost to India 1-0 on the fourth place. So that was the highlight of our career, and I think a lot of my friends here would like to. Would also agree that that is the best we perform, and the other side here was that we were very fortunate that we were I was a member of the Sikh Union Club or the Simba Union after that, that we had about 11 or 12 out of 16 playing, which means we understood each other, we knew each other, we knew what is going to happen next. So there was no need for us to make any noise here. It was just as the ball was moving, and you knew the person knew where is the next move there. I think, ladies and gentlemen, I would like to stop. And it's playing at an Olympic level. It is not difficult, but not very easy as well. It demands a lot of practice, a lot of sacrifice. Thank you.
Just like Balbir Singh is a very famous popular name in India, Surjit Singh is again a very famous popular name in Kenyan hockey. The position of center half has been filled by Surjit Singh in 1972. Surjit Singh though, he played in 56 and 60. Surjit Khanesa, he played in 64 and 50 years. The next speaker is a hockey journalist who's covered hockey worldwide. He's the founder editor of World Hockey, he's involved in the publication of World Hockey, the 25th edition. He's also been publishing the International Hockey Newsletter since 1964.
Teams, they weren't ready for that. But they got better, and they had a wonderful draw against Germany, who won the gold medal. So that was an outstanding achievement. They had two other draws, if I remember rightly, and they won the last game. And that's the only time they've ever won. So that's a rather historic moment. I'm very happy to see some members of that team here today. The Munich game should have been followed with a match between the Olympic champions and the World 11. I was lucky enough with Paul Spine to be asked to raise that team, and we watched a lot of games and we made a short list of who was going to play, and then unfortunately we had the hostage business, and the whole Olympic program was delayed one day, and that meant the final of the Olympics was one day late, and that was the day we were going to play our World 11 match in Berlin. Unfortunately, some of you might be even better known names today had we ever had that game, but we didn't. But just the same, I think Nearly everybody I see in this room today has given us an enormous amount of pleasure in speaking as an English journalist. Thanks very much.
Thanks.
There were 29 Sikh hockey players who played at the most games. 12 of them are in this room. Can I just ask them to stand one at a time? I know the Vinder Deegan is there.
Fellow Olympians, distinguished guests, respected Mr. Medallist, and friends and guests. Like perhaps I'm not a great speaker, but I will try my best to give you my personal experience of the Olympics. I don't have a fantastic memory, unlike Mr. Balbir Singh. I wasn't even born then, he can remember all the things. So I've jotted my personal experience straight after the Olympics, because I knew that I'd be asked one day to stand up and give these briefs. And straight after the Olympics, obviously, you get inundated with a lot of requests for interviews, and sometimes it was easy just to photocopy pages and send them through. Being an amateur sportsman, holding a full-time job, so it's always difficult to make time.